At CAC, they use a beam of protons, specially designed for that. And at Berkeley, they use the 120 GeV protons of the main ejector. Then you put the protons into a target. This target is a very relevant piece of hardware, because it's not at all easy to put hundreds of kilowatts or maybe megawatts of power, because this is what we are talking about. The total power, real energy, you dissipate into the target is on the order of several hundred kilowatts up to 1 or 2 megawatts. It takes an important system for cooling down the target, and also significant technology to handle the radiation around it. Of course, you have a huge amount of radiation around the target, so you cannot go there. Even after the beam is off, you have to wait several weeks or months before you can go there, which means that you have to remotely control everything and use radiation hard devices, electronics. It's a very challenging technological thing. And then, once you've done that, you have a large fire beam, because the main particle produced in the collision of a proton into a target is a large fire flux, which is what you want. So then you have a decay pipe, you have a magnetic system that collects the fires of the wanted momentum. Either you want a narrow beam, which means a very well-defined energy beam, and you will select ions with a well-defined momentum. If you want a wide band beam, you will have a more less selective system in which you accept ions of very different momentum. This depends on the kind of beam you want to do. But you need a magnetic system, usually with the shape of a horn, which is a standard technique to focus the pion, and with bending magnets to select the momentum. So you select the momentum, and then you use the horn to focus and try to put the pion all into the same direction. You need to focus the pion in the right direction. After the horns, target the horns, target horns, okay, same logic. Then you have some kind of a decay pipe. You need a long pipe. The length, of course, will depend on the momentum of the pion, because you have to let the pion decay. The C tau of a pion is about 3 meters. Then, of course, you need to boost depending on the energy. So if you are at few GeV, the boost is about 10 or 20. If you are at 100 GeV, of course, the boost is 1,000, so you need kilometers. In this case, in the typical case, you have several hundred meters of decay pipe. For example, with the 100 GeV proton formula, you have 775 meters in order to get the right amount of pions decay. Because you want the pion to decay,
yes,
to produce the muon neutrino. Because if the pions interact, then you are dead. Because if you make a strong interaction, you want that. So you have to leave the pion decay and obtain a muon neutrino beam. You will not get a pure muon neutrino beam for 2 reasons. A small fraction of the pions will decay in a plus QV. This is 10 to the minus 4 effect, because you know very well, I hope, that because of the electricity conservation, pions do not decay into electrons, but decay into neutrons. that also you don't select biop only, but you select chaon of the same momentum, and you cannot avoid it, because your magnetic system will collect charged particles depending on their momentum. You cannot select the mass. So you have a contamination of chaons, and the chaons can do some electronic decays with both electron and muon and neutrinos. So you have another contamination larger than that one, at the level of a few percent, of contamination of electron and muon and neutrinos of the other flavor. So you get wrong assigned muon, because the chaon can decay, giving you the wrong sign, and you get also electron and anti-electron. So your mean will be mostly at the level of 10 to the 3, will be mostly muon neutrinos, but with some contamination. Interesting enough, this contamination is small, but for the next generation experiment, it's not absolutely relevant, and it's not very well known. In order to measure very well the characteristic of the beam, usually all experiments, in particular the current super K experiment, Keck to super K, which is called the T2K, have a closed detector. You have a specific detector close to the beam production, specifically designed to analyze very well the energy distribution, the angular distribution, and the flavor content of the beam. Because you cannot make a very high, very precise prediction. The cross section of the production of pion is known, but is known within a few percent typically. But even less known is your efficiency in collecting the pion, and the momentum you collect, and the contamination of chaons you get, and so on. All that depends on your setup, on your accelerator, on your beam line. And if you need it very precisely, as next generation experiment we need, because so far we have done a first generation experiment in which you wanted to see the effect. Okay? Now we want to study next to million orders. You want to measure precisely. And this makes a requirement on the quality of the beam, which by themselves are a challenge. An important trick is the so-called off-axis neutrino beam. Why this? If you are on axis, so if you look at the neutrinos that are produced in the same direction of the pion beam, you get a broad spectrum, okay? This is an example of the energy spectrum of the Fermilab beam with the main neutrino beam and, as I told you, the contamination, which is in this case, as you see, it's very large. There is a 7% contamination of the wrong muon neutrino, and at the level of 1% the contamination of electron type neutrinos. The energy distribution of the neutrino is roughly one half of the energy distribution of the pion, because the pion at rest decays with a neutrino and